You're watching Channel 4.
Tonight, the first stage of the NFL playoffs begin as the Minnesota Vikings take on the Los Angeles Rams and the Houston Oilers return to Cleveland for a rematch with the Browns in the wild card games.
Good evening. Well, I hope you all had a good Christmas and are now looking forward to the NFL playoffs in the coming weeks. This week, the four wildcard teams play to decide which two move on to join the six divisional champions in the race to Super Bowl 23. And remember, it's sudden death, so don't expect the players to be holding anything back. In the AFC, Houston plays Cleveland for the right to do battle with Buffalo next week. In the NFC, the Los Angeles Rams play the Minnesota Vikings. If the Rams win, they will play the Bears, but if the Vikings win, they will travel to San Francisco for the 49ers. We'll see highlights of that match later in the program. But first, let's go to John, who's in Cleveland for their game.
Welcome to Cleveland, Ohio, where today the Browns host the Houston Oilers in the AFC wildcard game. As you may have seen in our program last Tuesday, Cleveland beat the Oilers in the final weekend of the regular season to earn the right to host today's game. The Browns go into this matchup with a psychological advantage after their come-from-behind victory last week, which was sealed by veteran quarterback Don Strock's touchdown pass to Webster Slaughter.
Throw, open, touchdown Cleveland! Webster Slaughter! So Strock, who was almost run out of town in the first half, now becomes the toast of Cleveland, Ohio, with a line drive strike for a touchdown.
Don Strock will start at quarterback again this week, as Bronny Kosar is still not fit enough to return to the team. The good news for Houston is that the weather conditions are a lot better than last week. There's no snow or freezing temperatures. It's been raining here all morning. So instead of the ice ball from last week, we've got the mud ball this week. The good news for the home fans is that number one running back Kevin Mack is back after injury. So too is all-pro cornerback Hanford Dixon. For the Houston Oilers, the main thing to do is forget about last week's defeat to the Browns. But there's one section of this Cleveland crowd that's not going to let them do that very easily. It is, of course, the dog pound. Now, last week against Houston, you guys were losing 23-7.
Right.
Now, you're a supportive crowd, but did you really think they'd come back 23-7 down?
Yes. We got all the confidence in the world in our buddy Don Strock. If you're going to have a backup quarterback, let it be Don. All the confidence in the world. He'll take us all the way.
He's a savior. He's our savior. If we have to lose Kosar, we would rather have somebody with Strock experience come in and take over for us like he did.
It's a real football, John. We got the rain coming down, cold weather, and you gotta love it. On grass.
They had the nerve to call this a rat hole, and they play in an indoor stadium. I heard it for last week's game to warm up for it, to try to simulate the conditions here at the stadium. They tried to practice with their footballs packed in dry ice, so they'd have cold football.
I think the Houston Oilers are going to go down 30-10. They're going to go down.
As you can see, the dog pound's all pumped up. So let's see how their beloved Cleveland Browns do as we join the action.
So along with match commentators Bob Trumpy and Don Crickey and 80,000 Browns fans, Houston are at a cold and wet Cleveland Stadium for the second time in 7 days. On the Oilers' opening drive, quarterback Warren Moon's pass was intercepted by the Browns' safety, Felix Wright. This resulted in Matt Barr converting a 34-yard field goal to give Cleveland an early 3-point lead. We join play with Houston on their next possession. They have a first down and 10 at the Browns' 44-yard line.
Warren Moon, who was going downfield to his wide receivers last Sunday, has been hitting his backs a lot today. And the Oilers are moving the ball on the second drive. Three ball. Warren Moon finds it, but he loses
loses about 7 or 8 yards. Bob Golic was quickly in on him, number 79 for Cleveland.
That ball seemed to go right through Warren Moon's hands as if he was not ready for the snap. This is a mistake in a game like this that you can't afford. No, he's ready. Oh, Tennyson can't get it off the ground. He never got the thing up. It slipped out of his hand. Boy, is that lucky for Houston that it bounces back there for the quarterback to pick it up. Tennyson has a glove on one hand, and his snapping hand does not have a glove on it, but it slipped right out.
Tough down now for Warren Moon, second down and 17. Wrong side of his intended receiver at the 40-yard line. Drew Hill couldn't make a play on the ball. Mark Harper was right with him, 23. And so now third down and 17 arises for the Houston Oilers. Drew Hill, 85, having a phenomenal year. He caught 72 passes. He'll start in the Pro Bowl for the AFC. 10 for touchdowns. Had almost 1,200 receiving yards this year. His ninth year out of Georgia Tech.
He and Givens once again combined for the most receiving yards in a season. They were second last year. And neither one of those kids is very big. Hill about 5'9", 170. Givens maybe a little smaller, but they'll catch it over the middle.
Third down and 17. They're looking at him now. Here's a long ball and out to Curtis Duncan, who's knocked out of bounds at about the 33-yard line. Frank Minifield covering on the play. Duncan, a very fast wide receiver from Northwestern, ran a down and out as Minifield had backed off, and a good throw by Warren Moon.
And we mentioned the Cleveland Browns don't like to play zone, but watch the safety drop here. You'll see the corner over in the side drop out, and then the receiver just finds the dead spot in the zone. Cleveland does not want to play zone, but with the bad footing, you can see the defensive backs dropping off, and the out pattern is there for a big pickup. This is not a defense that Cleveland prefers to play. They want to get up there and bump and run and intimidate the receivers as best they can.
High back, deep back, Lorenzo White. Up back is Alonzo Highsmith as they get set to run Lorenzo White gets it inside the 30 on the first down carry down to the 29-yard line. Felix Wright was on the tackle on the play.
And they caught the Cleveland Browns in a blitz. You can see that this offensive line is a lot bigger than the Cleveland defensive line. That time they run right at Clay Matthews. He's got an inside blitz, and they get the ball outside.
1:35 to go, first quarter, second down and 7 coming up. Oilers had great disappointment last weekend. At the start of the weekend, they had a chance, they thought, to win the AFC Central. Then the Bengals came back and beat the Redskins in overtime, and the divisional title was not theirs. Cincinnati won it. And they had a chance for the home field by beating Cleveland at a 23-7 lead and couldn't hold it. Option run by Warren Moon on a second down and 7 carry. He's down close to the 27-yard line. Felix Wright came up from the free safety to hit him.
Michael Dean Perry did a good job, too. Jumped inside the offensive right guard, and he was really there to make Warren Moon grab a hold of his shirt. Moon couldn't really run the option the way he wants. I'll identify Michael Dean Perry here. He's sitting right over the guard. Matthews, watch him jump inside the block, and that's what really ruins the option. See there? He's right there to grab a hold of Warren Moon's jersey. Moon can do nothing with it. Picks up a couple of yards, which is a very good play.
Haywood Jeffries goes on the left flank. Duncan on the right flank. As they keep Hill and Givens inside and swing it out to Drew Hill, and he's inside the 20-yard line. And on a third down and 5 play, the Oilers are ahead for a gain of 10 yards and a first down.
Don, does this offense look similar to what Miami runs? Backs out of the backfield, wide receivers running short routes. In the second to last game of the regular season, Miami got to this Cleveland defense for 400 yards, and I think they exposed this defense a little bit. Houston last week did the same thing. A lot of things out in the flat, the short patterns, and it's really gotten them down the field today, Houston.
This is a very, very important drive for the Oilers after an early mistake that led to Cleveland points, a field goal. The Oilers now possibly driving towards a go-ahead score. Pitchback, Lorenzo White at 210 pounds, cracks again inside. This time the 15-yard line, cutting back right at the linebacker, Junkin and Johnson. It's a gain on the play of 2 yards, second and 8.
Again, a nice little trap. You see the 74, Matthews pulley kind of leaves the picture, and then Junkin coming from the inside. These are very, very mobile linebackers as the quarter ends.
They make
a lot of tackles away from the play.
And that'll do it for the first quarter. Browns 3-0. Dry and no wind at the outset. Now the winds that could gust to 50 miles an hour are starting to sweep in off Lake Erie. There was serious concern that Cleveland Stadium, that is normally on Lake Erie, could be in Lake Erie before this one was over with an inch of rain forecast. Rain is falling, not that heavy, but the winds have really come up. Second and 8. Houston trails 3-0. Pass goes, and Alan Pinkett finds a way, and he goes in. Alan Pinkett, who at 5'9", 185 pounds when he was at Notre Dame, was one of the three strongest players in the entire team, uses that strength here to break tackles, and he cracks in, and all of a sudden, the Oilers rally on a long drive, 92 yards, and they go in for the go-ahead score. They lead it 6-3.
In 17 plays, Pinkett breaks the tackle of Frank Minifield, considered one of the best tacklers on the team. Watch this. Now, Minifield's got to make that tackle. Make it, as you said, with that great leg strength, breaks it. Junkin misses him, gets it into the end zone on a 2nd and 8.
Run that drive, Jim.
Boy, with the wind blowing now and the rain, that's a big touchdown for Houston.
He knows where the end zone is. That's his 10th touchdown, Alan Pinkett. And Zendejas, kicking in very poor conditions now, delivers the extra point. And so, with just 7 seconds gone in the second quarter, the Oilers on a long drive rally to take the lead, to the joy of Coach Glanville. Second longest drive of this season for the Oilers, officially 91. They went 98 for a score and a win over the Eagles.
That's got to hurt Cleveland's feelings. This defense is not a defense that historically has given up long drives in 88.
Zendejas set to kick off, and he delivers downfield deep. It'll now come out. Taken 8 yards deep in the end zone, and so the Browns will elect to go from their 20, 1st and 10. Well, both these teams are good at coming from behind. Particularly the Browns have come from behind in 3 of their last 4 games to win. Last Sunday, down 23-7, winds are starting to pick up even more, and the rain's getting heavier. So these early points could be very large before this is over. 1st down and 10 now for the Browns. Loose ball. Oilers have it at the 16-yard line. Richard Byrd, the nose tackle, shot the gap. And so there is a huge... Look at these Oilers on the sideline doing these weird dances to celebrate a turnover.
Jerry Glanville told us last night, one of the things that his team needs in every game is to bring their personality to the stadium. They want to hammer that line of scrimmage. You see that Don Strock never gets the ball from the center, Riccozzi. Byrd is the nose tackle, 71, shoots right by Riccozzi to make the fumble recovery. I couldn't really tell whether Riccozzi didn't get it up there or Strock moved out. There's no question now. Again, Cleveland kind of stepping on its own foot, just as they did last week against this team.
So the Oilers, who scored on a 17-play drive on the long drive, now go to Alan Pinkett, who turns the corner, and Alan Pinkett's inside the 5, and again, he goes into the end zone for a touchdown. With breakaway speed, Alan Pinkett turns the corner, outruns the cornerback, and gets a 16-yard touchdown run. And the emotion has been taken out of this Cleveland crowd of almost 80,000 as the Oilers, on consecutive possessions, have put touchdowns up and lead 13-3.
That is a beautiful cutback. This play is designed to go right. He's running right at Clay Matthews, and then gets back outside. It appears someone loses containment. The outside guy, Sam Clancy, 91, the defensive end. You're supposed to contain that run. And the Houston Oilers sideline, they recognize what's coming. Domingo Bryant, Richard Byrd, the guy in the fumble recovery. 6 points, Houston.
And Zendejas hits the extra point, up and good. And so with 14:38 to play in the first half, it is 14-3 Oilers.
So Houston take full advantage of the fumble to increase their lead. Unfortunately for quarterback Don Strock, in trying to recover the loose ball, he fell on his wrist and was unable to continue in the game. So replacement Mike Pagel stepped in for the Browns. He showed no signs of nerves and masterminded a 76-yard drive. But the Browns couldn't get the ball in the end zone, and once again Matt Barr had to come in and kick a 27-yard field goal. Towards the end of the half, Cleveland again reduced Houston's lead with another three-pointer when their offense again sputtered close to the goal, and Matt Barr had to kick a 28-yarder. The Oilers missed an opportunity for a touchdown in the final seconds of the half when Warren Moon's pass was intercepted in the end zone, but they still led by five. Join us again after this break. Welcome back. Early in the third quarter, Cleveland were once again well within field goal range when running back Ernest Byner was called for two successive penalties and was lucky not to be ejected when he allowed his frustration to get the better of him. It put Cleveland out of field goal range and they were forced to punt. Decisions continued to go against the Browns on their next possession when this 25-yard pass to Webster Slaughter was ruled incomplete, even though the replay clearly showed he had both feet in bounds. That call ended the drive and Cleveland had to punt. So we rejoin play with Houston in possession. It's second down and eight.
You have to admire the way the Oilers have maintained their poise in this cauldron of sound whenever they have the ball, particularly at this end. Second down and eight. Swing pass, and it's slapped away. Almost a lateral. If there was a lateral, it's six.
Matthews
has it. He might be reviewing this. He tried to swing it out to Alan Pinkett, but if he threw it back, it wasn't forward. It goes as a free ball, and Matthews has a live ball in his hands when he went in.
The determining factor is going to be, oh, wait a minute. This is going to be this is going to be very, very interesting.
This gets Trumpy going here.
Oh, I like this. This is the reverse angle. Now watch where Warren Moon throws the ball from. 57, Clay Matthews is there on the blitz. He's thrown it from the six. That's a lateral. That's a lateral. That's a lateral. He's behind the five-yard line.
By the end of this day, George Slatsy could be the most famous or infamous person in Cleveland, Ohio. The replay man doing the best he can.
All right, let's try to
look at this now.
Let's try to look at this just as he's about to throw it. There's his foot right there. You can see the five-yard line. And then when Alan Pinkett catches it, this is so clear, I don't even know why I'm doing this, but I'm doing it anyway. There's the five-yard line. There's no question in anybody's mind that that's a lateral. That ball's behind the five-yard line.
Wait till you hear this. You're going to hear emotion erupt that you won't believe. Clay Matthews gets a delayed touchdown if the hands go up.
After further review of instant replay, it was determined that we had a backward pass and not a forward pass. The covering official hit the whistle when the ball was incomplete. Consequently, going backwards, it will be Houston's ball.
No.
On the 5-yard line.
That cannot happen.
Cleveland can
no.
The whistle was blown.
On a backward pass, the ball is live. The whistle cannot blow. The ball is live on a backward pass. This cannot happen. There is no whistle blown.
Determined that it was a backward pass and not a forward pass. The covering official, signaling incomplete, ruled and blew the whistle when the ball's on the 5-yard line. It will be Houston's ball.
But the whistle cannot blow on a backward pass. The ball is live. They just got the shaft, I think, twice. How in the world can that call be made?
I don't know who's angrier, Trumpy or Art Modell, the Cleveland owner in the booth
right next
to him.
There's only one guy to make that whistle blow, and that is Jerry Seaman, the referee. That play cannot stand. There is no way in the world that the whistle can blow when the ball is a backward pass. The ball is live. The line judge, they say, blew the whistle. The line judge is 7 yards away. Unbelievable.
But the play call stands. It is Houston's ball. Third down and 15. As
catches the ball for an Oiler first down out to the 27-yard line.
Look, you know what they just did? We're going to listen to the play full speed. Here's the ultimate irony. They gave Houston the ball at the spot where it was dropped by Alan Pinkett. They snapped that ball from the 5-yard line. So they're saying it's a lateral. Cleveland recovers it. Houston gets the ball. That's as bungled a call as I've seen.
And then after that throw from the end zone, the Oilers get a first down. Now Houston goes to the run on first down and 10 with 5 minutes and 15 seconds to play in the third quarter. Still a long way to go on this one for Coach Glanville and Coach Schottenheimer. Second down and 7 now for Warren Moon and the Oilers. Penalty marker comes in. Time ran out. Delay of game. Warren Moon from the shotgun on second and 12. Long ball. The coverage is good and there's no play at the 45-yard line. Curtis Duncan was the intended receiver. Minifield, 31, was running stride for stride with him. You know the Oilers aren't going to get a call here after what went against the Browns.
Yeah, the Oilers have gotten their share. Last week, the ball bounced in the second half for the Cleveland Browns. Off helmets and shoulder pads and into hands. And today, the calls have gone for the Houston Oilers. Minifield, step for step. He's with Duncan, and that's what Duncan is complaining about. He does not get the call.
Hanford Dixon is back in at the right corner now. When out, he's troubled by that leg muscle injury, a pulled quadricep. Minifield was covering on that play. Hanford Dixon at the lower portion of your screen covering. Warren Moon, he can roll if he has to. He's intercepted by Cleveland. Mark Harper picks it off, and he's back inside the 25-yard line. A 15-yard return. The defensive backs were right where they had to be, waiting for the throw.
There's another flag at the end of the play. When Moon scrambles, he's in a certain amount of desperation here. Harper, who last week was victimized, bounces it around, catches it. There's also a flag. Don't know who it's on, but there's also a flag. A face mask maybe on the guy who made the tackle. Yes, sir, that's what it's going to be, face mask. Three guys in coverage.
Well, they worked that tip drill, and there's the benefit of it.
Warren Moon, you mentioned earlier in the game, it's Alonzo Highsmith who makes the tackle with the face mask. You mentioned earlier about Warren.
Personal foul, 15-yard face mask, 32 defense. First down.
You mentioned earlier about Warren Moon and his 2-1 touchdown to interception ratio, but against Cleveland, he's now thrown 6 touchdowns and 18 interceptions against this team in his career against Cleveland.
Now the Browns challenging again for what could be the go-ahead touchdown. They thought they had it on the defensive play by Matthews. Matt, cut down. Big defensive hit by Johnny Meade, the right outside backer, who caught him shin high and knocked down 240-pound Kevin Mack, who, despite his size, Mack is one of the fastest players in the Browns team.
Now the Cleveland defense did its job. Got the ball back in the hands of the offense. The offense has been down here now 4 times. Come away with just 3 field goals.
The Cleveland Browns, who've rallied from behind at halftime in 3 of their last 4 games, trying to do it again today. They're down to a 1-game season now. Pitchback goes to Patineau, and there's a beautiful open field hit. Steve Brown made the first connection, number 24, and then he was finished off by the pursuing linebackers. So the Browns, on second and 11 lose yards, is going to be third down and 14.
Again, a huge down for Cleveland. They've dominated in the second half, but they have no points.
Score stands as it did at halftime, 14-9 Oilers.
Zone by Houston. Zone.
Hagel looks it over. Goes into the Darius Slaughter, and the Browns take the lead. The same man who brought them back last week from behind, Webster Slaughter on the payoff end. This time it's Mike Pagel who delivers a 14-yard touchdown throw.
Houston goes to zone. Watch the cornerback drop off. Patrick Allen. Webster Slaughter realizes it. Jeff Donaldson bites on a good fake by Pagel. He looks out the flat. Webster Slaughter is wide open, and Ernest Biner celebrates big time.
2:36 to play, third quarter, as Matt Bauer drills the extra point up and good. And the Cleveland Browns have now rallied from behind. There's a penalty marker down. The extra point going to go against the Oilers.
Offside, defense lined up in the neutral zone. The extra point is good. 5-yard penalty, 6-yard kickoff.
This Pagel has done some job.
Pagel looks to the outside, and that's all it takes. Jeff Donaldson, 31, bites outside, and that dead spot in the zone is open for Slaughter, and a huge catch for the Cleveland Browns.
This Slaughter has really come back after an 8-week absence with a fractured arm. He played against Miami, and in the most important game of the season when the Browns had a win last Sunday, he caught 6 passes for 136 yards, including one for the winning touchdown. And now today, he brings the Browns from behind, this time off the throw by Mike Pagel. Lorenzo White back and ready to bring it back for the Oilers. Barr hits a high spinner. It'll carry short, and Lorenzo White takes off. Works his way out to about the 23-yard line where Warren Moon and the Houston offense come back out. See what Warren Moon, not much happening for him, a terrific first half, accepting the 2 interceptions by Felix Wright. Mark Harper picked him off the last time he ran the Oiler offense, and that was turned into the touchdown on the throw to Webster Slaughter. 16-14 Cleveland with 2:26 to play, third quarter. AFC wildcard game. Winner goes to Buffalo, losers out. First time in 9 games that the tight end Jamie Williams had a ball thrown to him. He doesn't get it often, but he appreciates it when he does, although he banged his elbow coming down.
Watch the offensive line in the trenches. There's a lot more holding allowed now than used to be allowed in the NFL. Here's Munchak on Big Daddy Hairston. It happens any way you can get it done nowadays in the NFL. These guys are so big. Williams with his catch. Lands right on his shoulder.
First down and 10. Moon out pattern. Nicely done to Drew Hill, who breaks it across midfield, and he's down inside the 45-yard line of the Browns. Felix Wright, who has 2 interceptions today, ran him out of bounds, but the gain is good for 18 as Warren Moon's right arm quickly gets the Oilers out of jail, deep in their own end. Glanville has that long rider coat on, something from the old West. And it's a shoot 'em out here today at Cleveland Stadium. Pinkett, a dancer, darts in and out and cuts back and did well to get just 2 yards down to the 41-yard line. Very important consideration here, Trump. Career Zendejas, the Oiler field goal kicker, has hit 7 of 11 over 50 yards. So if it comes down to a long boot, he can deliver it.
There he is on the sideline, keeping his leg warm. That heater looks like the tail end of a 727. That red hot metal in there.
Second down and a long 7. Almost 8. It open on a draw play, and Alan Pinkett takes it inside the 20 and all the way down to the 14-yard line. 27-yard gain by Alan Pinkett, who's been called on today to spell injured Mike Rozier. Rozier was listed to start. Nobody talked about the seriousness of his rib injury. He hasn't carried it one time. Pinkett's been as good or better today.
So the third quarter ends with the Oilers still trailing by two. Join us for the fourth quarter after this break. Welcome back. Houston are in possession at the start of the fourth quarter, trailing by two. It's first down and 10 at the Browns' 14-yard line.
Lorenzo White looking for room to run. At 210 pounds, he has extraordinary quickness. Glanville thinks he's going to be his franchise runner in due time. Rozier is right now, though Rozier's out today with rib injuries. He did dress, play just one play as a wide receiver. Duncan goes wide left. Double tight end set on second down and six for the Oilers. 2 points behind. Lorenzo White cuts back. And White takes it down close to the 5-yard line. Gain of about five on the play. Sam Clancy at left end, number 91, made the stop for the Browns.
Don, one of the things that both teams have done very well is cut back. You watch the offensive line. There's a pull by Matthews, and Lorenzo White, you can see him pushing and shoving up there. Lorenzo White goes behind all of that blocking for a nice 5-yard pickup.
10 of Cleveland's 16 points came right after turnovers. Now Warren Moon moving the Oilers to a tough place to play football if you're the visiting team, the open end of Cleveland Stadium. With the super rambunctious dog pound right behind him, and that might have thrown their execution off. A marker's down.
Against Houston. Running back jumped out of his stance.
Defense. Illegal motion. 32 offense.
Offset.
Offsetting penalties. Repeat third down.
Players on both sides left before the snap. So a power down comes up for the Houston Oilers. Third down and one.
Boy, this game will edge you. And playing in this stadium as a visiting coach will add about 20 years to your life. Cleveland Browns have lost their starting quarterback. Mike Pagel, who has not played in 10 weeks, is in. And Cleveland leads.
Lorenzo White is the D-back, and he gets the pitch behind Highsmith. Lorenzo White is down to the 2-yard line. He has a first down for the Oilers. As Highsmith, at 240 pounds, kicked out and just blew away a defender coming in with an angle on the ball carrier. Lorenzo White gets the first down, and so now the Oilers will go point-blank range at the two.
Great athletic ability by Lorenzo White. Cleveland had defenders right in front of him. He jumps over them for the first down.
The swing and emotion here is remarkable. From absolutely a deafening roar, Cleveland Stadium went up again as the Oilers looking to go ahead. Have it first and goal. Lorenzo White, he's in. Touchdown Houston. And the Houston Oilers go in front 20-16.
Unbelievable. These two teams have played two of the best football games in back-to-back weekends that, Don, I think you and I have ever seen. A range of emotion, highs to lows, comebacks. Watch the block here by Alonzo Highsmith. An excellent block. He puts Junkin right on the ground. Eddie Johnson, 51, tries to make the tackle. Lorenzo White in the end zone.
4-point advantage for Houston, looking to extend it to five now. Zendejas will try the point after. Brent Peace, first-year player, coming up the strike team. And the extra point is good with 12:25 to play in the fourth quarter.
So thanks to Lorenzo White's touchdown, Houston once again regained the lead. We rejoin play with the Browns on offense. They have a second down and 20 following a 10-yard penalty.
Four wideouts as they go from the shotgun. Pagel gets gets time, stands in, delivers a ball to Clarence Weathers that he catches somehow at the 48-yard line. He got back about 9 yards. That'll bring up third down and 11, so Pagel is faced with a big throw here.
Bostic was the man in coverage. They're giving him good time to throw. You see Weathers going down there on Bostic, the strong safety. Just turns in and the ball is thrown outside. Weathers does a good job hanging on to that thing. That was a rifle shot. Third and 11 for the Cleveland Browns.
Biner in to block. He picks up the blitz. Pagel stands in, lets it go downfield. Free ball. It is almost picked off. Maybe it is.
It is.
They're going to rule it an interception. Richard Johnson was the man who got it, an extra defensive back, a number one pick out of Wisconsin 4 years ago, who's yet to gain a starting role. So a tip ball, and Richard Johnson capitalizes, and the Cleveland drive is stopped with 6:30 to play.
So Mike Pagel's pass was tipped and intercepted at a crucial point in the game. Houston used this possession to run down the clock, and with 2 minutes left, they added three valuable points when Tony Zendejas converted a 49-yard field goal to increase Houston's lead to 8. We rejoin play after the kickoff with 1:49 remaining. Cleveland have a first down at their own 29-yard line.
Ozzie Newsome has a long receiving streak that could end today. It's actually a regular season streak, so it could still be alive depending on the official ruling, but the Browns have much more than that to concern themselves with now. With first down and 10, they don't get much. With 1:38 to play, the Wizard of Oz looks out in what might be his final game as a Cleveland Brown after all those great seasons. His 12th year from Alabama. Pagel again stands in, throws up the middle. The Oilers are giving them all they want down the middle because the Browns can't stop the clock. 1:20 to go, and the Browns trail the Oilers by 8, 24-16.
They need to get the clock stopped here. Throw to the outside.
Looking for the out pattern now. Here's a long ball downfield. It is caught at the 40-yard line. They rule it a reception.
Webster Slaughter on the catch. This is the true prevent defense by the Houston Oilers. Going to keep every running back and receiver in front of them.
The Browns get a strike downfield inside the 20-yard line.
Now what Pagel's got to do is, well, he's not going to do it. I was going to tell him just throw the ball down to the ground. Stop the clock. There he does.
Yep. Pagel throws into the end zone, and it's incomplete, but there's a marker down. It'll be first and goal. Cleveland Browns will make it close, but can they come back?
Pass interference, number 29 defense, on the 2-yard line, first down. The pass is ruled incomplete.
He wanted to make amends for what he called the worst game of his career last Sunday here at Cleveland Stadium, and that was the reason for his worst game. Webster Slaughter beat him all day long.
Ozzie Newsome in the ball game here. They need to score, and they need to throw it. They can't run it because the clock continues to run. They need to throw it here.
Throw it they do, and to Webster Slaughter it goes. It is a touchdown for Cleveland, and the Browns are now back to within 2 with 31 seconds to play.
Is this unbelievable?
It'll come down to the final gun. The onside kick is everything.
This is just a little slant pattern run by Webster Slaughter. You can see that Keith Bostic, the strong safety, is the man in coverage, and Slaughter knocks his arm away, gets in the end zone, and Pagel puts it right on the money.
The extra point attempt coming up is insignificant. Browns trail by 2. They have to get the ball back and kick a field goal. Extra point nonetheless is good to make it a 1-point game with 31 seconds to play. Houston 24, Cleveland 23.
The Browns' only chance to regain possession was on a short onside kick. But amazingly, the first two attempts resulted in somewhat obscure penalties which require the kick to be retaken. So we join play with the Browns trying their third attempt.
Another try. It's up in the air. It's free ball.
That's touched illegally by Cleveland.
I'd wait for the officials to tell us.
Cleveland touched that ball before it went 10 yards.
Cleveland might have the ball, though, Trump.
See if we can pick it up from this angle.
The Oilers come up on the ball. They can touch it anywhere they want.
Yeah, see, there it's touched. There it's touched by the Cleveland Brown player, and this game may never end. They're going to have to kick it again.
Again, an extremely unusual situation.
They're going to have to kick
it again. We have the kicking team illegally touching the ball prior to it going 10 yards. Since we have that, following an illegal short free kick out of bounds, by rule, the ball will go to the receiving team at the spot where it was touched. First down.
George Glanville has about had it. He's be happy to get out of here with his long rider's coat, his players, and a one-point win.
We are definitely on the last page of the rule book.
So a bizarre ending as Houston run out the remaining time. The Oilers came out eventual winners, 24-23.
I think full credit to the players. We were really down after last week. We were really disappointed, and just about everybody colored us dead. And when that happens, we usually get up off the floor. In the backs, I thought Pinkett played great, and I thought Bula Bula came in and did a good job. And a lot of players just mustered up and allowed us to win this big game. This win is very significant because it's in the playoffs, on the road, in the bad weather. And to get to Miami, you're going to have to keep playing in this type of weather. So I think it was is better for us to win here than it was at home.
I feel a little more comfortable, though, if we were a little more consistent on offense. There were spots today where we didn't play as well as we probably should have. The fact is, a win is a win, and that's what you got to be excited about.
I think our defense played up to par, and we forced them to get field goals when they wanted touchdowns. I think that was the factor.
Coach, your relatives in Cornwall, England, are going to be proud of you when they see this game.
Cornwall and Cameron. We need to go back. We were there last summer, got to see them, and we wish all of England a Merry Christmas, and you can tell them one of their own still in the playoffs.
So the Houston Oilers gained sweet revenge for their defeat last week, and they'll now go even further north into colder weather to play the Buffalo Bills next week.
Well, that game to me typifies what playoff football is all about. Two teams fighting, clawing, and doing whatever it takes to keep alive in the playoffs. There were a lot of key plays, but perhaps the most important were two non-calls by the referees, one on the lateral pass from Moon to Pinkett, and the other, a pass completion to Webster Slaughter on the Oilers' 12-yard line, which was called back, and the drive ended in a Cleveland punt. Well, Houston's win means they play the Bills next week in Buffalo, and Seattle plays the Bengals in Cincinnati. Yesterday, the NFC played their wildcard game in Minnesota, where the Los Angeles Rams took on the Vikings.
Outside the Metrodome, a foot of snow lay on the ground as the Twin Cities of Minneapolis-St. Paul were hit by near blizzard conditions. Inside, however, the temperature had been raised to 84 degrees to melt snow off the dome roof, which once collapsed in similar conditions 5 years ago. It must have made the Rams feel pretty cozy, but that feeling...
Ray Berry from behind.
Offense, the Vikings ran out 28-17 victors.
So Minnesota will travel to San Francisco, and Philadelphia will play Chicago in the divisional playoffs. The two games next Saturday will be featured 24 hours later on New Year's Day, and the games from Sunday can be seen a week from today on Tuesday, the 3rd of January. So the field is reduced to 8, with the elimination of the Los Angeles Rams and Cleveland, who were one of my preseason picks to win it all. So the Super Bowl is only 2 games away for the remaining teams, and you too could be in Miami as winner of our competition in association with the Daily Telegraph. In a moment, we'll show you 12 players. The first letter of each of their surnames forms an anagram which has a connection with American football. Find out that word and send it on a postcard to American Football Competition, P.O. Box 604, The Daily Telegraph, 181 Marsh Wall, London, E14, 9SR. Your entries need to reach us by Friday, January the 6th, and remember to enclose your address and phone numbers. So until next Sunday, when I'll be in Chicago, good night, good luck, and a happy new year.